President of Uganda, His Excellency Yoweri Kaguta Museveni, hosts presidential candidate Raila Odinga. That and more stories in our bulletin today. Thank you so much for joining us and always being part of us. My name is Nahawe Kajura, but first, other headlines. Parliament directs government to terminate Vinci Coffey deal. Army gets 64 billion shillings for operations in the Democratic Republic of Congo. In our sports today, Lois Chepkwemoi scoops gold in 2,000 meters steeple chess. Once again, thank you so much for joining us. We start with one of our top stories. Now, Parliament's Committee on Trade has directed government to terminate an agreement it signed recently with Uganda Vinci Coffee Company Limited. Now, the resolution came after the tabling of the coffee agreement report by the Chair of Parliamentary Committee on the Trade, Honorable Mwene Mpaka, who was charged with responsibility of investigating the matter after concerns were raised to Kabonera MP Abedi Bwanika.
According to the findings of the report read by the Chairman of Parliament's Committee on Trade, Mbarara City South MP Mwene Mpaka, the committee found that the agreement signed was not in tandem with the different provisions of the law. The committee further found out that by allowing VINCI priority of buying Uganda's coffee at a 60,000 tons per year will create monopoly in the sector. The committee also found out the said company had no capacity to meet all the agreement terms in the agreement in spite of being registered in 2014 and allowed operations in 2015. It's from the above concerns that the committee resolved that the coffee agreement be cancelled. Government considers agreement to be cancelled. Government regularizes its dealing with VINCI, extends similar tax exemptions to local companies dealing in coffee, capitalize UCD. Parliament also demanded that officials who committed government to such illegalities should be penalized as a different deterrent mechanism to stop similar occurrences in the future.
Away from that, Parliament has approved 152 billion shillings to facilitate the Uganda People's Defense Forces' offensive operations in the Democratic Republic of Congo and Karamojo sub-region. Now, this is part of the 617.9 billion shilling supplementary schedule number 2 for the financial year 2021-2022 that Parliament approved during the plenary sitting on Thursday, 19th May 2022. We have the report.
The Minister of State for Finance in charge of general duties, Honorable Henry Musasizi, said that supplementary expenditure, which is coming barely a month to the new financial year, has been warranted by expenditure pressures from 10 votes to cater for salary shortfalls, emerging security concerns, and other critical activities. Part of the approved supplementary expenditure of 77 billion shillings has been allocated to State House for classified expenditures, while 86.3 billion shillings has been allocated to the Office of the President to cater for external financing from Exim Bank for the National Science Technology, Engineering and Innovation Skills Enhanced Project. 25 billion shillings has been allocated to the Ministry of Works and Transport to facilitate works on security roads in Karamoja region, while 251.7 billion shillings will go to meet wage shortfalls under various central and local government votes. Among other expenditures include 2.5 billion shillings for Ministry of Gender, Labour and Social Development to facilitate election of the office bearers for the Uganda Muslim Supreme Council, 1 billion shillings for Fort Portal Catholic Diocese, and 600 million shillings for Greater Ankole Diocese to facilitate for the Uganda Matters Day celebrations 2022.
Well, thank you so much, reporter Nalugo. Moving on in our top stories, the Uganda Medical Association, a body that unites all medical and health workers across the country, has called upon the parliament to respect the presidential decision of enhancing the salaries of doctors and health workers across the country. Now, the call was made by Dr. Oledo Samuel Odong, the president of the association, while addressing the media in Kampala. Ahumuza has more.
In November last year, President Yoweri Kaguta Museveni directed that the monthly salary for doctors and medical workers, not forgetting the internees, be increased, and for intern doctors, the president ordered that be increased from 750,000 shillings to 2.5 million shillings. However, this was given a cold ear, forcing the doctors to go for an industrial action starting 1st May 2022. While addressing the media in Kampala, Dr. Oledo Samuel Odongo, the president of the Uganda Medical Association, a body that unites all doctors in the country, said they have resolved the calling of the industrial action, thus calling upon the parliament to ensure the presidential directives are implemented.
I call upon the Speaker of Parliament, honestly, Cabinet has spoken. Can the members of Parliament implement this? You saw what happened in COVID-19. We have been struggling to bring doctors in the diaspora to come back so that you're not able to fly out of the country. The services you got to get out are brought closer here. The time you get an emergency and you come to a facility that has to save your life, and the people who are meant to save your life are not there, or are there, but because they sebwa are not there, people will watch you die, even if you're honorable member of parliament.
He further said that they stand in solidarity with the allied professionals who of recent also demanded a salary increment, but advised them to negotiate with the government.
We are glad, by the way, allied health workers came out clearly to bring their issues. We are standing with them, and we are hoping government works on their issues and their issues are resolved. Because as doctors, we work with our colleagues in allied. So we encourage them also, as they choose to lay down tools, let's have a lot of dialogue with the government. Let this process end as fast as possible. We come back, you work with doctors and nurses in hospitals to save Ugandans at such a time when the economy is crashing. So we cannot use the predicament of Ugandans against our own interests. We can't use that. But we are hopeful that their issues are going to be resolved. So we call upon government, please, can you resolve these issues as fast as possible? Because we don't want the promises and the trust that you have with doctors to be taken for granted, that later you can cause us to actually cause for a mother of all mothers of industrial actions.
Dr. Odongo revealed that over 3,000 doctors in the diaspora have agreed to return home and invest in the country's health sector. It should be noted that for a long period of time, doctors and medical workers have been complaining over poor remunerations and lack of incentives across the various government facilities, saying it undermines their abilities to deliver services to Ugandans.
Thank you so much, our reporter. Africa Today takes a quick break. We shall come back with the international news. Welcome back for the break. You're still watching TV Africa, the right to know. In our international news, President Museveni has hosted Kenyan presidential candidate in the forthcoming election, Raila Odinga, who paid him a courtesy call at State House on Thursday. Now, the two leaders discussed a wide range of issues. We have the report.
President Museveni said that he was happy to receive presidential candidate Raila Odinga, who paid him a courtesy call at State House in Tebe last evening, and discussed a wide range of issues concerning the two countries. Raila Odinga tweeted that they walked down a memory lane to discuss the shared history of their countries aimed at forging stronger ties moving into the future. The development comes on the heels of the forthcoming general elections in Kenya, set for August 9th. President Museveni last year hosted Deputy President William Ruto, who is in a hot contest with Odinga to become Kenya's next president. Museveni last year said Uganda is ready to work with whoever is elected president of Kenya. Museveni reaffirmed his support and willingness to work with Kenya to strengthen the fraternal bonds of friendship and cooperation that exist between the two countries. Earlier, it had been reported that Museveni was secretly supporting Ruto's candidacy, but by making it clear that Uganda will support anyone elected the president, sought to put the same to rest.
Now, no one knows the technicalities of the visit, but we pledge to keep updating you. Moving on, in international news, the UN Assistant Secretary General for Africa told the Security Council that terrorism and insecurity continue to spread in the Sahel, devastating the lives of millions of people. Now, Martha Amar said that civilians are often the main victims of terrorism acts, and the suffering and loss suffered by civilian populations at the hands of terrorist groups are indescribable.
According to the UN official, Paul B, now more than ever countries in the region need to step up efforts to uphold and protect human rights because future generations also pay the price. She added that uprooting terrorist groups who are often deeply enmeshed or embedded with communities is uniquely challenging in the Sahel and has rendered counter-terrorism operations immensely difficult to carry out. In the coming months, the Assistant Secretary General said that it will be crucial for stakeholders in the region to come to a consensus on how to best bring the transitions in Mali and Burkina Faso to a swift conclusion and in a manner that addresses the grievances of the populations in each country. From the civil society, the coordinator and president of the Rights and Resources Initiative Group, Solange Bandiaki Baji, briefed the council members about how climate change impacts conflict dynamics in vulnerable countries. According to Bandiaki, not considering these dynamics could result in an incomplete and flawed analysis because climate change affects the availability, distribution, and quality of natural resources, which can escalate conflicts over those resources.
Moving on, in international news, conflict and natural disasters drove millions of people from their homes last year, bringing the total number of displaced people to a record high of nearly 60 million. According to a study released on Thursday by NGOs, we do have the report.
Internally displaced people numbered 59.1 million in 2021, nearly half of whom were under 18 years old, according to the Internal Displacement Monitoring Center and the Norwegian Refugee Council. Year on year, this figure, which therefore does not include refugees abroad, continues to grow, and a new record is expected to be set in 2022 due to Russia's invasion of Ukraine, which began on February 24. This is the second highest annual figure in a decade, behind 2020, which saw a record number of displacements due to a series of natural disasters. More than 8 million people were internally displaced in Ukraine, more than 2 months after the invasion of the country by Russia, according to the UN. Although the number of people displaced by conflict continues to grow, natural disasters remain the primary reason people are forced to flee their homes, with 23.7 million displacements in 2021. 70% of the internal displacement related to natural disasters in 2021 was recorded in China, the Philippines, and India.
Away from that, South Africa was embroiled in a new racial flare-up on Monday after a white student was filmed urinating on a black student's books and laptop at one of the country's top universities. Now, Stellenbosch University, which described an incident as racist, said that it had immediately suspended the undergraduate student, whom it did not name. We have the report.
According to a cell phone video circulating on social media, the man bagged into the first-year black student's room at a hall of residence in the pre-dawn hours of Sunday and then urinated on his belongings. Stellenbosch said in a statement that university strongly condemned the destructive, hurtful, and racist incident. South Africa has been roiled by a string of racial disputes that have exposed deep divisions 28 years after the end of white minority rule. The South African Students' Congress say that victim had been asleep when he heard noise in his room, adding that when he woke up, the racist white boy was urinating on his study desk, books, and on his laptop. Asked what he was doing, the racist response was that it is what they do to black boys. The country's students, the university's students' representative council say that incident was an example of the harm that follows marginalized communities, and in this case, black students. Protests were held on the campus on Monday, gathering students of all races. Many South Africans, including former students, took to social media to vent their anger about Stellenbosch, with some saying the university, regularly ranked as one of the best in Africa, had an entrenched problem, elitism and racism.
Africa Today takes a quick break. We shall come back with business, health, and sports. Welcome back for the break. You're still watching TV Africa, The Right to Know. Talking matters business, the Private Sector Foundation Uganda will hold the first ever Uganda Democratic Republic of Congo Business Summit between May 31st and June 8th in Kinshasa and Goma in the Democratic Republic of Congo. Now, the Prime Minister of Trade, Industry and Cooperatives, Francis Mwebesa, will lead the Uganda delegation to DR Congo, which will include government officials and private sector members.
The summit is expected to attract more than 200 participants from Uganda and DRC, seek to open up new business frontiers, as well as consolidate trade relations between Uganda and DR Congo through discussions of business linkages, trade fairs, and engagements between the governments and businesses during the 10 days in the Democratic Republic of Congo. The Minister of Trade, Industry and Cooperatives, Francis Mwebesa, say that DRC is one of Uganda's biggest trading partners in East Africa, with Uganda exporting mainly cement, palm oil, beer, sugar, iron and steel, rice, cocoa beans and natural rubber. The summit is jointly organized by the Private Sector Foundation Uganda, Uganda National Chamber of Commerce and Industry, Uganda Manufacturers Association and various government ministries. DRC was formally admitted into the East African Community Region bloc on March 29, 2022, bringing together a market size of more than 250 million people. Speaking ahead of the summit, the Private Sector Foundation Uganda Chief Executive Officer Steven Asimwe said the entry of DRC into the East African community now provides the Uganda business community with an opportunity to trade in a market that has a population of more than 90 million people.
In Africa Today Health, Mozambique has detected a case of the wild poliovirus, the first in 30 years after neighboring Malawi reported a similar detection 3 months ago, according to the World Health Organization announcement on Wednesday.
According to the World Health Organization, the case was diagnosed in a child in the northeast province of Tete, adding that this was the second imported case of wild poliovirus in South Africa this year after Malawi in mid-February. Laboratory tests showed that the newly confirmed case is linked to a strain that was circulating in Pakistan, as was the case in Malawi. Africa had been declared free in August 2020 when all forms of wild poliovirus had been eliminated from the continent. It takes no cases for 4 years to achieve it. The internal organization has increased vaccinations in Malawi and surveillance has been strengthened in neighboring countries. Since the detection in Malawi, Southern African countries have launched a vaccination campaign, with Mozambique immunizing 4.2 million children against the disease, according to World Health Organization. Malawi and its four immediate neighbors, Mozambique, Tanzania, Zambia, and Zimbabwe, want to immunize 23 million children aged 5 and under in the coming weeks. Polioviruses cause irreversible paralysis and even death. It is transmitted through the stool of an infected person and then contaminates water or food and multiplies in the intestine. There is no treatment, but vaccination prevents infection and transmission, which has made it possible to virtually eradicate wild forms. The vaccine was created in the 1950s but remained out of reach in poor countries in Asia and Africa until a major mobilization in recent decades.
In sports news today, Uganda had a colorful Thursday, May 19, 2022, with 4 medals in athletics at Stade Helitas in Kane City during the ongoing ISF Games in France. Now, Lois Chepkemoi scooped gold in the 2,000-meter steeplechase for the girls. Another gold medal was recorded by Maureen Chebet in the 800-meter girls.
Under chilly, windy weather conditions, Uganda's athletes braved the high thato and friendly confines to clinch different medals. There were two bronze medals on the day from Prisca Akelo in 800 meters girls steeplechase and Dolphin Chelimo in 800 meters boys. Chepkwemoi led from the start to finish with an incredible kick to win the competitive race with a timing of 6 minutes, 36 seconds and 62 microseconds ahead of Francis Jordan Melisande with 6 minutes, 41 seconds and 50 microseconds. Third place and the bronze was taken by Romanian Flor Stefania Arelia, who raced 6 minutes 45 seconds and 22 microseconds. Kazakhstan's Akbeyan Namament and another French Dajax Magot completed the top 5 positions with 6 minutes 48 seconds and 47 microseconds and 6 minutes 49 seconds and 57 microseconds times respectively. Another Ugandan, Financia Chepkwemoi, was 9th out of 15 runners in the first race with a time of 7 minutes, 2 seconds, 57 microseconds. There was merrymaking for the gold that was also followed by Maureen Chebeti's gold medal in 800 meters girls. Two bronze medals from Dolphin Chelimo in 2000 meters boys steeplechase and Prisca Akelo in 800 meters girls galvanized the day for the East African athletics powerhouse. Uganda's medal tally now increases to 5 in the competition after the earlier silver medal by Victor Cherotich in the 3000 boys event.
It is at this particular time that I thank you for being part of us and always joining us. Don't forget to subscribe to our YouTube channel. We shall keep updating you. It is TV Africa. The right to know.